Now, this is something Paul has said to them, that they had to pray for him because Paul was being persecuted, having trouble. You see, the Thessalonians were being persecuted. They were having trouble. And at first, Paul comforts them, instructs them, and encourages them. And now he lets them know that he also is undergoing persecution, difficulty. If you stand for the Lord, why, it will cost you something. Now we saw then the walk of the believer. Before, we had seen the Word of God in the life of the believer. And now the walk of the believer, because the Word of God should be in him. Now we come to the work of the believer. And again, may I say, this is, I think, something very practical. It's something that's quite real and something that we need today to get engaged in. That is the Word of God, and that the Word of God may have its way in our hearts and in our lives. Now, as we come here to verse 8, and that is where we are, let me read it to you. Verse 8 of 2 Thessalonians, the 3rd chapter. Neither did we eat any man's bread for naught, that is, for nothing, but wrought with labor and travail night and day, that we might not be chargeable to any of you. Now, Paul's practice apparently was that when he went to a place and he was a missionary, that he would not let anyone there, and that especially applied, I think, to his first journey there, he would not let anyone support him. He would not let anyone pay him. And therefore, when Paul arrived in town as a missionary, there wasn't a reservation for him at the local motel, at the Howard Johnson Motel, or the Holiday Inn, or a Hilton Hotel. And there was no stipend given to him. They didn't take a love offering for him the first time that he was there. He was very careful, apparently, about that. He tells that to the Thessalonians, and you'll find him also to the Corinthians. And apparently it was his practice that to every place that he went in establishing the church, this was his policy, that he worked. He worked at tent making over in Corinth, you remember. Now I think that after the church was established and Paul had visited it the second, third time, that he did receive an offering. Now you find that he certainly makes it clear to the Galatians that they should give. He thanks the Philippians for their gift, and he took an offering on his third missionary journey for the poor saints in Jerusalem. And he didn't mind doing that, by the way. But this apparently was his policy. In other words, the great truth of the coming of Christ was not something that caused Paul to become some sort of a fanatic and take some unreasonable position. We've had people that did that back in the last century. Many people sold their homes, their property, and got white sheets and got on top of the roof waiting for the Lord to come. There's several things about that that always seem to me to be the mark of a fanatic. To begin with, why get on the roof? After all, he can take you up from the floor level as well as on the roof, and if the roof was any help to you to get up that high, then why not climb up in a tree that you could get up maybe 50 to 100 feet in the air and maybe go to a mountaintop? That might be better. And why in the world you'd have a white sheet? I think the Lord's going to furnish us our uniform. I don't think we'll need to worry about that, but that's the way these people did. And why in the world did they sell their property and turn it into money? They didn't think they were going to carry that with them, I'm sure. People can do some very funny, peculiar things because they say they believe in the soon coming of Christ. Now, my friend, there's nothing that's going to make you work as hard as that great truth. If you really believe it, You're going to work. You're going to be busy for the Lord in some phase of His work, in some part of the field today. You're going to be putting a few seed in the ground of the Word of God that it might bring forth a harvest, by the way. Now, Paul makes that